Hello everyone. So from today onwards, I'm starting a new lecture series on viruses. So this is the first lecture, and today I'm going to discuss introduction to viruses, general properties of viruses, and we'll have some light on history of virology. So starting with introduction to viruses. Now, what are viruses? So viruses are very tiny particles. They are tinier than the microorganisms like bacteria. So we can call viruses as submicroscopic particles. These are made up of nucleic acids, either DNA or RNA, enclosed within a protein shell called capsid. Some of the viruses, mainly animal viruses, they have extra envelope around the capsid, which is mainly made up of lipids. So why am I using the word particle for viruses? See, viruses, these are particles, because we call them particles because they are not they are acellular, because viruses do not have their own metabolic machinery. Viruses do not have any system for extraction of energy, and these do not have their own replication, transcription, translation machinery. So like other cells, like all the other organisms, they have their own metabolic system and their own machinery for replication of their genetic material, for transcription and translation. So unlike that, viruses do not have their own machinery of replication and transcription and translation, even extraction of energy. So that's why viruses, they are called particles, because viruses cannot generate energy. They cannot even move themselves. They are just particles. They just lie around and cannot reproduce themselves. So that's why viruses are particles. And before going over to discuss the properties of viruses, I would first like to discuss why it is important to study viruses, why viruses are so important. Because viruses, they are responsible for number of diseases. Since ancient times, man has battled viral diseases. For example, smallpox. Smallpox had been there since ancient times, and it has been eradicated because of the vaccination just 41 or 42 years back. But it was there. So smallpox was there. Then there are other diseases like dengue, and there is Ebola, and there was AIDS. I mean, there is AIDS also, HIV, and now we have coronavirus. So viruses, they are responsible for number of deadly diseases. It is important to study viruses, and it is also speculated that there are number of viruses which we have not yet encountered. I mean, interestingly, I saw one article on National Geographic. I will give you a glimpse of that article. There it was written that there are more number of viruses on Earth than the stars in the sky. So we have number of viruses, there are large number of viruses which we have not yet encountered. I mean, it is said that there are viruses which are there, which lie deep into the ocean. There are viruses which lie deep into the glaciers, and many wild animals, they also carry viruses. So as we will have exposure to those viruses, we will have problems. We can have more number of diseases. So that's why it is important to study viruses. Because as the glaciers are melting due to the global warming, and there is lots of deforestation happening due to the increased population, so there are very high chance that in future we will come in contact with those viruses, and there is a great danger to the humankind because of that. Apart from that, viruses also have a positive side, as they are being used in medicine and therapeutics these days. It is used as a vector and recombinant gene technology, recombinant DNA technology, and the best example these days is Covishield, which is a virus vector based vaccine, where the adenovirus from the chimpanzee is manipulated in such a way that it carries the spike protein gene of the coronavirus, and basically the adenovirus act as a delivery vehicle. It delivers the spike protein gene to the cells of our body so that immune response can be generated against the spike protein. So apart from that, bacteriophages are there, and in some countries research on bacteriophages, you must be knowing, bacteriophages are viruses which kill bacteria. So they have a potential use in bacterial diseases. So that is also there. So this was a little about introduction of viruses. Now let's move further. So before moving on to the properties, I wanted to show you this article written published in National Geographic, and this is: there are more viruses than stars in the universe, why do only some infect us? So this seems to be a very good article, and this article is published in 15 April 2020. So this should be a very good article, and I recommend that you all go through this article and read this. So you will have a very good piece of knowledge about viruses. So please go through this. Now let's start with general properties of viruses. So first property of viruses is that these are acellular. And acellular, I've already explained that viruses do not, these are very simple molecules. They just have a nucleic acid and protein, protein shell surrounding them. And these virus particles do not have any organelle. These do not have any metabolic system. These viruses do not have any kind of machinery for synthesizing their nucleic acid, for synthesizing RNA, synthesizing protein. These, that no chemical reaction takes place within a virus. Okay, so that makes them acellular. Okay, so another property is that viruses, they have either DNA or RNA as genome, but not both. Almost all viruses, they have either DNA or RNA as genome. But there is one exception, and that is human cytomegalovirus. It has a DNA copy as well as four copies of mRNA molecules. Now I'll show you that paper which was published in Nature. Yeah, this is paper which was published in August 2000 in Nature Medicine. And they're saying that human cytomegalovirus no longer just a DNA virus. So here what is written in the bold letters, you can read, that is, human cytomegalovirus is classified as DNA herpes virus. A recent study showed that HCMV virion, focus on the word HCMV virion, contains not only DNA but also 4 species of mRNA, indicating that this virus is more complex than the previously believed. So the fact that human cytomegalovirus has RNA along with DNA, it has both DNA and RNA, this fact was established in August 2000. Okay, so this is one exception. Now let's go back. So the third property is obligately intracellular parasites. Viruses are obligately intracellular parasites. So these are parasites, these are infectious in nature. Viruses cannot reproduce themselves, so they need to infect a host in order to reproduce. So that makes them obligately intracellular parasites, because without infecting they won't be able to reproduce. So what happens when a virus enters into the host cell? It actually take charge of the host machinery. It captures the host machinery, and it captures the host metabolic system so that it can replicate itself. So for that, one thing that a virus does is that it redirects the host metabolism so that more and more of, glucose enters into the cell. Because energy is required for the virus to replicate. Virus needs energy for its replication. So that energy requirement is basically energy is extracted from the glucose. So the energy requirement of the cell increases. More glucose enters into the cell. So there is a drug called 2-deoxyglucose. You people must have heard of it. It was designed by DRDO, and it was launched. It was manufactured by Reddy's lab. So the idea behind using this drug is to reduce the glucose intake of the virus infected cells, so that viruses don't get enough energy to replicate themselves. So I hope it is clear. Now let's move on to another property, the fourth one, and that is that the virus exists in two forms, extracellular form or intracellular form. So the extracellular form is the virion, and in the intracellular form is a form which makes the virus living, because in the intracellular form only, and the intracellular form is nothing but genetic material of the virus, DNA or RNA, and some proteins or enzymes associated with it. So it is the intracellular form that makes the virus living, because it is only active in this form. Whatever the virus does, capturing host machinery and replicating and self-assembly and all that happens in its intracellular form. So it is the virion form, the extracellular form is inactive and thus a particle in nature. So fifth property is metabolically inert. Viruses are metabolically inert. This I have already told you, that viruses do not have any metabolic system. It does not have any system for extraction of energy and using that energy, because nothing within a virion is performed. So no chemical reaction takes place within viruses. So viruses are metabolically inert. So I'm going to read these lines I have taken from Brock's book of microbiology, and these lines are very important. So I'm going to read them for you. So this is first para. So the virus genome moves from the cell in which it was produced to another cell inside the virion. Once in the new cell, the intracellular stage begins and the virus replicates. So this para tells us about the intracellular and the extracellular form of the virus. This para tells that the virus remains in the extracellular form outside the cell. Once when virus enters into the host cell, its intracellular form begins. So it also tells that the virus genome from one cell, the movement of virus genome from one cell to another host cell, one host cell to another host cell, takes place via the extracellular form. So there is the extracellular form, then there is intracellular form, then again there is extracellular form, then again there is intracellular form. So virus exists in alternative extracellular and intracellular forms. Okay, outside the cell, so outside the host cell, it is in the extracellular form. Then when it enters into the cell, then it gets converted into the into intracellular form. Then again, when it has to move from one cell to another cell, again it gets converted into the extracellular form. It is in the extracellular in the form of virion only. It can infect another cell. Then in another cell, again its intracellular stage begins, and this is what this para is telling. Now, exceptionally, there are some viruses like animal viruses such as polio virus or respiratory syncytial virus. They may skip the extracellular stage when moving from one cell to another within the same organism. This is very interesting. Certain animal viruses such as polio and respiratory syncytial viruses, they may skip the extracellular stage, that is virion form, when moving from one cell to another cell within the same organism. Instead, they mediate the fusion of infected cells with uninfected cells and transfer themselves in this way. This means that when, suppose, a polio virus infects a host cell, then within the host cell, the intracellular stage of the polio virus starts. Okay. So when the genome of the virus, polio virus, has to be moved from one cell to another cell, then it doesn't form virions. Virions are not formed. Rather, the transfer of the genetic material of the polio virus takes place via fusion of the cells together. The infected cell gets fused with the uninfected cell, and via this fusion, the infected cell transfers its genome to uninfected cell. So the movement of the viral genome takes place via fusion of the two cells together, and not via the virion form or the extracellular form. So this is interesting. And however, when moving from one organism to another, they are truly extracellular. So viruses, they have to jump from one organism to another. It is done only in the extracellular form, that is in the form of virions. So if the virus is broken down into nucleic acids, and you know, when the structure of the virus is disintegrated, that nucleic acid falls apart and its protein shell capsid falls apart, then virus loses its infectivity. Virus cannot infect in this disintegrated form. I hope you understood this. Another para which I wish to repeat for you is that viral genomes are usually very small, and they encode primarily proteins whose functions viruses cannot usurp from their hosts. Therefore, during replication inside the cell, viruses depend heavily on host cell structural and metabolic components. The virus redirects host metabolic functions to support virus replication and the assembly of new virions. Eventually, new viral particles are released, and the process can repeat itself. Now let's move on to history of virology. Now history is always interesting because history has stories attached to it, and stories are almost always interesting. So let's have a look on the history of virology. So what happened, first point is that ancients did not understand the nature of their illness. People used to have measles, rabies, polio, smallpox and other viral diseases, but they did not know what actually is causing the diseases, because at that time people did not know about microorganisms. So they had diseases, but they did not understand nature of their illness. And these diseases like smallpox epidemics, measles epidemics, these diseases have actually played, interestingly, these diseases have played role in the change in the history of mankind. There are two interesting examples. One is weakening of the Roman Empire, and the second one is European colonization of Native America. So I'm going to explain these a little bit. So during great epidemics of 165 AD to 180 and 251 AD to 266 AD, during these two great epidemics of measles and smallpox, the Roman Empire got weakened a lot. These two great epidemics caused a weakening of the Roman Empire, which eventually led to the falling apart of the Roman Empire. So these two epidemics have played a pivotal role in falling apart of the Roman Empire. Then around 15 and 20, this was a time when Spaniards, people of the Spain, Spaniards, they actually attacked the Native Americans, like Mexicans. Spaniards, they attacked Mexico, and during that attack, around 1520, people of the Native America, Mexicans, they got greatly affected with the epidemic of smallpox. It is said that there was a rescue team from the Spain which came to Native America for helping the soldiers. That team actually carried the smallpox virus, and then from them the smallpox virus was spread to Native America, and Native American, they had smallpox epidemic and they got greatly affected with the disease, and maybe that led to their defeat, because Spaniards, they very defeated Native America and they took over the Native America. So it is said that during European colonization of North America, smallpox played a major role. It is believed that Indian population of Mexico declined by 90% within 100 years of Spanish attack. It is believed that virus was probably brought to Mexico in 1520 AD by a relief expedition sent to join the Spaniards. So interestingly, people believe that God was on the side of Spaniards, because at that time people did not understood the nature of the disease. So they did not know actually the viruses are causing the disease. So they thought that God was on the side of Spaniards and not to Native Americans. So it was a God's wrath reserved for North Americans. And these are two interesting historical events for which the viral diseases have been responsible. So let's move further. Now let's move to the second point, and it is prevention of the viral diseases came much before discovery of viruses. So before the discovery of viruses as a separate infectious entity, technique for preventing viral diseases was developed. So basically there were two techniques, variolation and vaccination. So let's see that. So in 11th century, variolation technique was developed. It was developed in China. China was a origin of variolation technique. Then in 18th century, vaccination technique was invented, and everybody know father of vaccination, Dr. Edward Jenner. He developed vaccination technique. So, and there are other events also, and I'm going to explain all these one by one. So first of all, let's see variolation technique. So what is variolation technique? Variolation, actually, in the ancient times, people used to have epidemics of smallpox, and people used to get very badly affected because of this disease. It was a deadly disease, and as I told you, that in smallpox, mortality rate was very high, with 30 to 34 per people die, and only 70 people would survive, and that too, they would have those pockmarks on their face all over their life. So it was a very deadly disease, and so in China, one thing I would like to say that during ancient times, people did not understand nature of the disease, but they did understand the concept of immunity. It was observed very early time during maybe 400 AD, it was observed. That I'm not sure of the century, but concept of immunity was realized by people. People know about it. And what was that? That people who have smallpox, the people who recover from the smallpox, they would never have the disease in their whole life. People recovered from smallpox would never have smallpox again in their whole life. That means people had become immune towards the smallpox virus, smallpox disease. So this phenomena was observed by wise people, and in China, so they had this idea that if they would deliberately cause smallpox to the young children, then the weak children, some of the children, like around 30 children out of 100 would die, and 70% who would survive would not have the disease all over their life. So they thought that it is something advantageous that if they do so, parents would be saved from the pain of raising the children only in order to die them later in their life. So with that thing in their mind, they invented a variolation technique. So what variolation word comes from? Variola is a smallpox virus. So what happened in variolation technique, they used to take fluid from the pustule of the smallpox patient. You know, in smallpox, what happens? The patient has those small pustules all over his chest, his face, his arms. So they used to take fluid from those pustules from the active patient, or skin off the pustule, some scales of the pustule, dried pustules from the patient, and they used to rub those dried pustules or fluid or to inoculate the babies, young children. And then they used to like infect those children via doing this practice, like via inoculating the fluid from the pustule, or via the scales of the dried pustules, by rubbing the scales of the dried pustules on the skin of the baby so that they get infected. So this was the invention of the variolation technique. Then what happened, and as the time passed,
wise people, they observed that there are some mild cases of smallpox also. So when they used to take the fluid of the pustule or the scales of the pustule from a mild patient, that means when they used to inoculate children with the matter, the, you know, the infectious matter from the mild smallpox patient, then they observed that mortality rate in children was greatly decreased. Then less number of children used to die and more would survive. So then the technique changed, and then they used to like inoculate babies with the mild cases of smallpox. Then from China, the technique moved from China to Middle East. So in Middle East, people started inoculating their children with mild cases of smallpox patients, so that they get immune to the, they get lifelong immunization against the smallpox disease. So and the technique had modified by then a lot, because original technique was barbaric. I would say it was barbaric because they used to inoculate young children with deadly strain of virus, deadly disease. They used to cause, I mean, they knew that 30% of the children would die. That was a barbaric, and Chinese are famous for their draconian barbaric ways. Genghis Khan was also from China. So by 15th century, technique was well spread in the Middle East, and people were extensively using this technique of variolation for immunizing their children. So then this lady called Lady Wortley Montagu, in early 18th century only, this lady, she was wife of an English ambassador in Middle East. This lady went to Turkey along with her children, and there she observed that people are like variolating their children. So she also got variolated her children there in Turkey. So when she went back to England, she tried to convince people around her about this technique, and she wanted that people in England also get their children variolated. But she was not successful. People were not, she could not convince people for using this technique for immunizing their children against smallpox. But then around that time only, there was this piece of observation that was floating around in England, that people who work with cows, like the milkmaids and farmers, people who work with cows, they get infected with a disease, a cowpox disease, which they used to get from the cows. So there was this observation that those people who had the cowpox disease from the cows, they become immunized against the smallpox, because during the epidemics, these people, they never used to get smallpox disease. They never used to get ill because of the smallpox. So this was an observation which was like floating around in England. So during that time only, there was this farmer, English farmer, Benjamin Jesty. So in 1774, this Benjamin Jesty, in 1774, there was an smallpox epidemic going around in his area, and this Benjamin Jesty was also aware of this piece of information or this observation that people having cowpox disease, they don't get smallpox disease. So Benjamin Jesty himself had cowpox disease. He himself had the cowpox disease, and he, along with his two servants, lady servants, they also had the cowpox disease. So he thought that he had become immunized against smallpox. So he wanted his children and his wife also to be safe against the smallpox disease. And during that time, as I said, epidemic was going around. So what he did, he took his two sons and his wife to the cow shed where the cow was having the smallpox disease. So he got his wife and his children, his two sons, inoculated with the cowpox, the pustules from the fluid from the pustule from the cow which was having this disease, cowpox. So he took the fluid or the scales of the pustule or blisters. So he got his sons and his wife inoculated with that. But for his action, Benjamin Disty was very badly criticized. People said that what he did was something barbaric, because people did not know about, they were not convinced about variolation, which Lady Wortley Montagu wanted them to, try to tell them about it, but they did not believe in that. And so they thought what Benjamin Disty did was something very bad. But then eventually his sons, they got immunized against smallpox. And later on, many years later, Benjamin Disty did get credit for his work. But during his time, he did not get. So his son got the benefit. His family got a reward for what he did. But then in 1798, in fact in 1796, in year 1796, Edward Jenner, actually during that time Edward Jenner was also hearing about this observation that people having cowpox disease do not get the disease, smallpox disease. So Edward Jenner planned experiment in 1796, where he actually inoculated 23 people with the cowpox pustules from the milkmaids. There was a milkmaid, she was having the cowpox disease, so he got that pustule or the scales, the fluid of the pustule or the scales of the dried pustule, and he got all those 23 people inoculated with it. So first experiment that he did, his first experimental subject was an 8-year-old boy. So first he took that 8-year-old boy, his name was, I guess, James Phillips. So he got that boy inoculated with the cowpox disease, and then later he infected that boy with the deadly smallpox virus. And then he saw that boy, he actually attained the immunity, he had become immunized, so his experiment was successful. Then he did the same experiment in another 22 people. And then in 1978, he got he wrote the research paper and got published 23 successful vaccinations. And after that only he got the recognition, and he had actually invented a vaccination technique. And now he is the father of vaccination. So vaccination, if you look at the word vaccination, vaccination comes from vaka. Vaka means cow. So you see that by end of the 18th century, vaccination technique was developed. So that was for prevention of viral diseases, that is smallpox. So the third important point in history of virology is discovery of porcelain bacterial filter by Charles Chamberlain in 1884. So Charles Chamberlain, he was an associate of Louis Pasteur, because he used to work with Louis Pasteur. And Charles Chamberlain is also known for his discovery of an autoclave. The autoclave that we use today, not discovery, invention. Charles Chamberlain invented autoclave that we use today. So it was invention of porcelain bacterial filter by Charles Chamberlain, which played a very important role in the discovery of viruses. Let's look into it. So the whole 19th century was used or was spent in discovery of the nature of this infectious entity called viruses. So in 1892, which was end of the 19th century, near end of the 19th century, Dmitry Ivanovsky from Russia used Chamberlain's filter to study tobacco mosaic virus, tobacco mosaic disease. So there, the first disease to be studied, first viral disease to be studied was tobacco mosaic disease. It was a disease of a plant tobacco. And so what Dmitry Ivanovsky did, he actually took the infected diseased plant, crushed it, made an extract of it. Then he filtered that extract through the Chamberlain's filter. So the filtrate that came, he observed that that filter induced disease in other in fresh plants also. That bacteria free filter, that filtrate which was which he got after filtering the tobacco diseased plants extract, that filtrate which did not contain the virus was infectious. That filtrate was causing disease in fresh plants. He observed that. He attributed this to a toxin. He said that some toxin is present in the filtrate because virus is not there. So it was ruled out that this disease was a virus. Because bacteria was not there in the extract, so this thing was ruled out that this disease was a bacterial disease. Dmitry said that there is some kind of toxin which is present in that filtrate which is causing this disease in fresh plants. Then in 1898 and 1900, Martinus W. Pickering, he did a little extensive study on, more extensive study on this tobacco mosaic disease using the same Chamberlain's filter. So he also got that bacteria-free filtrate. And he also observed that this filtrate is causing disease in fresh tobacco plants, healthy tobacco plants. But he said that this is called this infection is caused due to some filterable virus. He said that there is no bacteria which is causing the disease, but there is a filterable virus which is causing this disease. That filtrate has a filterable virus. During this time, virus was the term which was used for any toxic material. Any toxic or any harmful material was caused, was called virus. Even Louis Pasteur used to call infectious agents as a virus only. So, Pickering said that it is a filterable virus. He said there is some and a living entity other than the bacteria which is causing the this infection. So any harmful agent, poison or venom, was called virus during that time. So this Martinus W. Pickering also made an observation that this virus would multiply only in living plant cells but could not survive for long periods in the dried state. So he made an observation that this virus is not any kind of particle. He said that this is a kind of
some living entity which could multiply only in the living plants and could survive for long periods in a dry state. So these were the two observations which were made by Martinus W. Bejering. So then in a separate study during that time only, Frederick Loeffler and Paul Frosch in Germany, they found that hoof and mouth disease of the cattle was also caused by filterable virus rather than by a toxin. So they observed this phenomena in case of hoof and mouth disease of the cattle. Then in 1900, Walter Reed showed that yellow fever disease was caused by, again, this filterable virus. And all of them, they used a Chamberlain's filter for studying this. Then by the beginning of 20th century, it was established that the filterable virus was responsible for plant, human and animal diseases. Then what happened next? In early 20th century, only viruses were linked with the cancer. In early 20th century, viruses were also linked with the cancer, where Wilhelm Illemann and Olaf Bang reported chicken leukemia caused by the virus. Then in 1911, Peyton Rouse from Rockefeller Institute of New York City reported that a virus was responsible for malignant muscle tumor in chickens. So you see that in 18th century and in early 20th century, it was clear that this filterable virus was responsible for diseases in plants, animals, humans, as well as it was linked with filterable virus was linked with cancer also. Then moving further, then in 1915, Frederick W. Trott discovered bacteriophages. Okay, so first it was discovered that viruses, they were causing diseases in plants, animals, humans. Viruses were also causing cancer in animals. Then it came that there were bacteriophages. So viruses, they were also found to infect bacteria. Okay, so in 1915, Frederick W. Trott discovered bacteriophages. So what Trott did? Trott isolated bacterial viruses that could attack and destroy micrococci and intestinal bacilli. What Trott did was very simple experiments, and Trott only speculated that it could be filterable virus that is attacking the micrococci and intestinal bacilli bacteria. So he only speculated that these filterable viruses are attacking and killing the bacteria, but he did not did more work on these bacteria killing viruses. And so the credit for discovery of bacteriophages was finally gone to Felix T. Herele. Felix T. Herele did an extensive work, and he established decisively the existence of bacterial viruses. So by in early 20th century only, it was clear that filterable viruses, they were living entities, and they were like infecting plants, animals, humans. They were causing cancer, and they were also killing bacteria also. So here you can see the famous experiment that Felix T. Herele did. What he did, he isolated bacterial viruses from patients with dysentery, probably caused by Shigella dysentery. So he noted that when a virus suspension was spread on a layer of bacteria growing on agar, clear circular areas containing viruses and lysed cells developed. A count of these clear zones allowed D. Herele to estimate the number of viruses present. So what DiHerrella did, he isolated the bacterial viruses from patients with dysentery. Okay, so here also he used Chamberlain's filter. So that dysentery he thought probably was caused by Shigella dysentriae, which is a bacteria. So what he did, he spread the virus suspension on the layer of bacteria growing on agar. After incubating it for some time, he observed clear circular areas containing viruses. The plaques were formed on the agar plate, on the viral lawn. So those plaques were formed, were having viruses and lysed bacterial cells. Okay. So a count of these clear zones allowed DiHerrella to estimate the number of viruses present, and that you will study in plaque assay. So I guess it is the DiHerrella who gave us the plaque assay. So DiHerrella demonstrated that these viruses could reproduce only in live bacteria. Therefore, he named them bacteriophages, because they could eat holes in bacterial lawns. So it was DiHerrella, Felix DiHerrella, who gave the name bacteriophages to the viruses which infected and killed bacteria, which infect and kill bacteria.
So by early 20th century, it was clear that these viruses are infectious agents, and these could cause infections in plants, animals, human beings. They could also cause cancer, and they also kill bacteria. And it was clear that these viruses, they cannot reproduce or replicate independently. They need a host in order to multiply. But by then, by earlier century, it was not clear about the chemical nature of the virus was not clear. Chemical nature of the virus became clear in 1935 when in 1935 Wendell M. Stanley crystallized tobacco mosaic virus, and he found it to be largely or completely protein. So it was Wendell M. Stanley in 1935, he crystallized tobacco mosaic virus. But he found that the virus is all made up of proteins. He could not find the nucleic acid component of the virus. But just short time later, Frederick C. Borden and Norman W. Peary. So Borden and Peary, they managed to separate tobacco mosaic virus particles into protein and nucleic acid. So by end of 1930s, it was clear, the chemical nature of the virus was also clear, established. So it was clear that the virus was made up of proteins and nucleic acids. So this was about the history of virology. So I hope you understand now that viruses, these are highly infectious agents. These are obligately intracellular parasites, because they cannot reproduce on their own. They need a host in order to infect. So they remain in two forms, extracellular form, which is the virion, and intracellular form. And the extracellular form is a particle form that makes it a particle, because in extracellular form, viruses cannot do anything. Viruses cannot even move. They cannot even move because these are acellular, because these do not have any metabolic system. So no chemical reaction can take place within a virus. And there are more number of viruses on Earth than the stars in the sky, and only few viruses we know, few number we know, and there are so many which are hidden in glaciers, deep into the ocean, into the wild animals. And in future we will come across with these hidden viruses, and that is going to be dangerous for us, because you know, viral diseases, everybody is seeing what is happening in case of this coronavirus infection. And about the history, it is clear that first people, the ancient people, they had the diseases, but they did not know about the nature of the disease. Then they got to know about the concept of immunization, that the people who recover from the disease do not get the disease in the future. So concept of immunity was first discovered, then was realized, and then the prevention of the viral disease, techniques for prevention of viral diseases were first developed. Variolation technique was developed, then vaccination technique was developed. Then in the whole of 19th century was spent in the discovery of viruses, in discovery of the viruses and nature of the viruses. So by end of 1930s, it was finally established that the virus is a particle and it cannot reproduce on its own, and its chemical nature of the virus was established, that the virus is made up of nucleic acids and a protein shell. So this is it for today. I hope things are clear. If anything is not clear to you, if you have any doubts, please ask me, write on the comment box, or my students can contact me on the Google Classroom. So, have a nice day. Bye-bye.